You as a TC, single commuter, and welcome to this session of Microsoft Festival. Today, I'm joined by Deep Goguri as a presenter. She's a SQLDB administrator, and I also have Fabiano Lira as a moderator. So, guys, whatever doubt you have or query you have, feel free to him, to speak and drop that on our Q&A panel. So, Depp, on behalf of Brazilian SQL community, thanks for joining us. Today, we are really happy to have you along with us. So today we are going to talk about query store, right?
Yes.
Before you proceed with this session, I have one question, okay?
Sure.
To kick us off, what is the query stores and what is the scenario you recommend to this feature to be used?
That we will all discuss in the session. Can we directly
All
dive into the
right.
session?
No spoiler, right? Okie dokie. Yeah, no spoiler. So you are free to start whatever you want.
Sure.
Okay.
Let me share my screen. Let
If
me
I change my face,
see.
no worries because I'm still doing something on my homework. So
Oh my God, Portuguese language is so beautiful. It is so soothing to mind. If I listen to
yeah.
that, I might not
Oh
understand,
gosh.
but I can sleep properly. I can
Oh no,
sleep very well.
yeah.
It's like
I
so
talk.
soothing. So let me know when to start the act.
Yeah, you can start.
Oh, awesome.
Yeah.
So hello everyone. Thank you so much for taking your valued time for attending this session today. It's an honor for me to present here. Thank you so much for all the organizers and especially for Tiag for giving me this wonderful opportunity because he recommended me to go ahead and apply for call for speaker. So thank you so much, Tiag. Luckily, I got
Thanks.
selected. So today in this session, we are going to talk about query store, all about query store. So by the end of this session, you will be able to understand whether you have to go ahead and implement it, and positively you will be implementing it, So let's get started. A
Okay.
little bit about me. Please everybody mute yourself so that other people can listen to me. So a little bit about me. I'm a database administrator having several years of experience in managing SQL Server and databases. I'm a Microsoft certified trainer and Microsoft certified solution expert. I did my master's degree in computer technology at Eastern Illinois University here in United States. And I do blog for dbanuggets.com. That's my website, very active website. And I'm very active on Twitter as well. If you wanted to get in touch with me, just at dbanuggets is my user ID. And down below, that's my email address. So if you have any questions regarding this session later, please do not hesitate to contact me. So what are we going to discuss in this session today? We are going to see the overview of query store and how to force a plan using the query store. And we are also going to talk about automatic plan correction. How does that happen? But we are mainly focusing on how to actually force the plan using query store in this particular session. So what is the query store, right? Query store is a feature that got implemented in SQL Server 2016. And that feature actually, what it does is it will store all of your execution plans for your queries such that you can go ahead and check all those plans and make sure which plan do you wanted to implement and force to implement such that the other queries can actually use that plan which you have selected. That's what query store is all about. And you have the other option, which will automatically go and correct those plans even without your intervention, right? There are two methods you can do it. You can manually go ahead and force it. And you have that enterprise edition, like enterprise version of SQL Server, where it can go ahead and automatically correct. This is for only enterprise edition and also for the Azure databases. If you are in Azure, then you are automatically using the query store. If you're not in the Azure, you have to enable the query store at the database level. So we have two options, automatically as well as manually. We are focusing on manually this in this particular session, but we are also going to discuss about the automatical correction by the query store. So why should we even care, right? We should definitely care because as a DBAs and developers, we all have those performance issue queries, right? which are like really running very slow. And some of the queries have those hundreds of execution plans, and you cannot control which query, which execution plan you wanted to force it, right? Because you don't have any option to force until you have the query store, right? So this query store will actually help you solve performance problems, because it will help you choose the optimal plans for your queries, and it will also make your life easier. So let's go ahead and get started. So what is this query store, right? Query store feature is actually the database level option. It is disabled by default. You have to go ahead and enable it at each and every database that you wanted to enable the query store. So whenever you enable the query store at the database level, all the data, all these execution plans that are being captured by the query store are stored inside the database itself in the internal tables. And these internal tables always, right, always they are going to stay at the primary file group. And you cannot change that, right? It always go to the primary file group. And you can also enable that, the query store option, for even the system databases, but only for two system databases. You can enable for MSDB and for the model database. You might be thinking, why model? We are not going to use model anyway, right? But model, if you enable it, we are not going to use the query store on model database. But then if you create any new databases, then it will actually get that features from the model database, right? And it will apply to the newly created database. You cannot enable the query store on master database or tempdb database. And if at all you have the high availability replicas, right? If you enable the query store on the primary replica, which is the read and write replica, that information, the query store information, will be populated into the secondary replica, which is the read-only, but the queries which are running on the secondary read-only replica doesn't get stored inside the query store on the secondary. Now, why? Because the secondary is only the read-only, right? We cannot write anything, we can just read. So it can only be enabled at the primary, where the read and write, and the data gets stored only on the primary. To view the information of the query store, right? If your developer come and ask you, hey, Tiag, I wanted to look what's there in the query store, then what permissions do they need? They need view database state permissions. But then if they are coming and asking you, can I go ahead and force a plan for this query? Because I want to take that, you know, responsibility of forcing and unforcing the query plans. Then you have to think about it, because now you have to give the DB owner permissions, which are like high privileges, right? If you give that, they cannot only force and unforce the query plans, but they can also delete the database, right? Because you are giving DB owner. So make sure you keep that in mind. So what's in the query store, right? Now we have known how to enable it, but what will actually stored inside the query store apart from these execution plans? So plans itself get stored, like the query text, query plan, compile time, duration, last execution time, all these information regarding the plans get stored inside the database internal tables for these query store. And it will also save the runtime stats like the CPU, memory, logical reads, physical reads, duration, execution counts, and then degree of parallelisms and log bytes used, tempdb, and wait stats as well, wait stats per plan. But the ones which you are seeing with the highlighted green color, those are especially for SQL Server 17 and Azure SQL databases. So to know more about these features, right, you can just go ahead and look into the Microsoft documentation, especially for these, each and every feature, which one to enable, which one to disable, those kind of things. So what are our main concerns, right, in our regular basis? What are our main performance concerns for our queries? We all have those queries which runs really slow, and we don't know why they are running slow, right? Sometimes we have those queries which just take long time to run. And some queries will take high CPU and memory. And there are other set of queries which are like really weird. For some parameters, they run very quickly. And the same query with the different parameters runs okay. and with this different set of parameters, the same query will take forever. It will not complete, right? Does this sound familiar to you? Yes, right? We all have those queries. So basically, in this particular session, we are mainly focusing on these variation in the performance depending upon those parameter sensitive queries that we are focusing on in this session. So if you have a query, right, the varied, the instability plans that you have for your queries, those performance degrading queries, those look like this. If a query have multiple queries, if you go to the query store to look into it, that particular query, a single query, have these many plans. Like when you see the right side of your screen, you see those plan IDs, like 6 of them. So for one single query, we have 6 queries, 6 execution plans. So you have to know which one to choose, right? But just think, if there is no query store, how do you fix this problem? How do you know which plan is actually better and which plan is not, right? So how do you solve these problems if you don't have the query store? By modifying the code, right? By looking into the code and see where the performance is degrading, you'll just go ahead and change the schema of the code itself, the stored procedure schema, to make sure that that particular query will generate the optimal plan. That's the main goal. We have to always keep that as a main goal, because that's the permanent fix, right? All of these other options, even the query store, it will help us to identify which one is the better plan out of like 20 plans. But then you have to make sure your queries will actually create the optimal plan and use the same plan all the time. That is our main goal. Sometimes you do not have, you know, your developer don't have much time to modify the code, then what we will do is just go ahead and recompile the option, right? You'll use the recompile. But does that solve the problem? It will always create a new plan, generate a new plan if you use that recompile. That means you are bloating your cache, right? Because you have those thousands of execution plans right now. And updating statistics. Some people think updating statistics will solve the problem. But updating statistics will actually recompile the plans when you run the next time the same query with a different parameter. What if the next time you are running the query, you are using a not so good parameter? That means you are also getting that not so good execution plan, right? So that's not a permanent fix. Updating stats doesn't solve the problem permanently. And then we do have plan guides previously to the SQL Server 2016. But then you can't force what plan you want there. And sometimes you just manually go ahead and DBCC proc crash, you'll just clean up the cache itself for that particular query. And then you create the plan using those optimal parameters that you know it will create the good plan. But do you think it's a permanent fix? No, right? So for all these problems, you have this query store, beautiful feature, where you can actually go ahead and compare all those plans, look and see and try to force a plan which you think will be the better performance, right? Which will give the better performance. So query store is the solution that we are talking about today. So you can actually force the optimal plan by choosing into different plans. And these force plans are not schema bound. And you can also check that extended events, you can create the extended events to help monitor if there are any failures on these forced plans. Because once you choose the forced plan, that plan will actually use it no matter what, right? But the forced plan which you thought good today might not be good tomorrow, right? After 2-3 months, that plan might be a bad plan because now you are adding the data and then changing the schema. All things are running behind the scenes, right? All users are using our database. So you have to keep monitoring it by using the extended events. So let's start the demo. This is more into demo driven. So let me go ahead and share my screen, the demo screen. Iago, are you able to see my screen?
Yeah, yep. We are seeing our screen. Let me check with someone else or if
management studio.
Yep, you can hear me. Yeah, I'm senior admin at SSMS.
Thank you.
So, tá todo mundo vendo aí o SSMS dela? Dá um ping aí, raise your hand. Who's not seeing her SSMS? A galera tá vendo. So please feel free and go ahead.
Yes. Everybody's awesome. Awesome. Thanks so much, guys, for for listening to the session properly. So so we are using AdventureWorks 2016 database. I just mentioned big because I just added two new tables, but that's fine. I can give you the script later if you want. So first, let's go ahead and enable the query store, right? We are enabling this query store right now. And then there are a couple of options we are choosing for that particular query store, like how much flush interval seconds and all the other settings. These settings, this is only for demo. Don't do this in production, because to do that in production, you have to make sure you read the documentation. There are a couple of blogs which describe about these options especially. I'm going to share that later down the session. So let me go ahead and do add those sessions, like a couple of sessions. And then let me go ahead and clear out the store, making sure that nothing is there in my store. And I'm going ahead and creating a store procedure, right? Very simple queries. This is one query. We have two queries in this particular store procedure. The first store procedure query is, we are just selecting a couple of columns from sales order header table, and we are joining with sales order detail table as well. And we are searching on the customer ID column, very simple. And the second query is, we are doing some of these two columns. We are doing some aggregation between the same two tables based upon the customer ID column. So let me go ahead and put this query into the database. So we created that store procedure, and let me go ahead and execute this particular store procedure twice, right? Using different parameters. And we are using recompile just to make sure they are creating two new plans. And these two parameters are actually parameter sensitive, meaning they will be creating different plans. So once the query store is enabled, you do not have to mention recompile, but I'm just making sure they will create two new plans. Let me enable the actual execution plan on. When I execute that, when you go to the execution, since the store procedure have two queries, it will give the two execution plan for each execution of the store procedure, right? So for the first store procedure, we got index seek and a key lookup. And when you see the second query in the same execution, same store procedure, you see the index seek, clustered index seek with a nested loop. When you see the second execution of the same store procedure, we got the same plan. If you observe this plan as well as this plan, both of them got the same execution plans. But then the second execution of the store procedure, the second query inside the second execution of the store procedure, you got a different plan. If you observe here, there is a parallelism thing going on here, right? If you observe this, these both are two different execution for the same query, right? So that means for the first query, we have only one execution. But for the second query, we have two executions, right? Two different execution plans. So let's go ahead and see if they are actually got created inside our query store, the query store folder, because we enabled it, you will be able to see it. If you do not enable it, you cannot see this folder, query store. So inside the query store, go to the top resource consuming queries, right click, view top resource consuming queries, and see. See, this is a little bit confusing, right? So let's go ahead and check this one.
Maybe just sorry for bothering you, interrupt you while you are talking, but we have a question. Can I do it right now?
Can we do this later? Because there is a lot of content.
Okay, yeah.
Sure, thank you. Okay. So if we press this button, we can easily see the queries itself to make us understand easily. So there are two queries, right? Inside one store procedure. So for the query one, we just have one execution plan, if you observe. But for the second execution, second query, we have two execution plans, two different ones, right? Now, let me go ahead and update bunch of data, right? Because our production servers always insert and update the data. Let me go ahead and update couple of data. So we are updating couple of data right now. It is taking a while because that's a lot of data. We affected these many rows. So now let me go ahead and execute the same store procedures with two parameters, right? The same parameters one more time. Now, if you observe here in the execution plan, the first query, this looks the similar execution plan, right? And then this looks similar as well. But for the second execution, this is completely different execution plan, right? And then for the first query, this is for the first query inside the second execution. And for the second query inside for the second execution, this even this is different. That means we have two different execution plans for the first query, three different execution plans for the second query, right? So let's go ahead and see that. We already have it open here in the top resource consuming queries. Let me refresh this and see the first query have two execution plans, right? And the second query has three execution plans. Now I can go ahead and compare the plans. See, we have two plans, right? So select that by pressing the shift and then select this and then this. And if you wanted to compare, go ahead and press this button to compare both the execution plans. Now, this is how you will compare both of the execution plans. Right here, it is using non-clustered index seek, but here it's using clustered index. So let's close this. We can compare it that way. That is what I wanted to show you here. But then for the first query, so how do you know the last created execution plan, right? You can check by looking at the highest value. Here 11 is the latest created execution plan. First one is the last created execution plan. So compare both of them. Which one do you want? I will take this particular first query. I wanted to force this one. Okay. So I have to just select that particular plan and then force the plan. Just a simple button, just one simple button. And then it asks me, do you want to force the plan? Yes. So if you force the plan, did you see the check mark here? That means this particular execution plan is currently active, currently forced. No matter how many times you execute the query again, it will definitely use this particular execution plan. And for the second query, let's go ahead and see which one will be the best. Let's go ahead and use query number two, right? Execution plan number two. It have that plan ID of two, right? Let me go ahead and force that by pressing force plan. And it asks me, do you want to force the plan? Yes. And when you see here, it already checked the mark, right? So now let me go back because they are already forced. Now let me go back and execute the query again to see whether it is actually using the same forced plans, right? When I execute that and check the execution plan, do you observe here? It is using the forced plans. And for the second one also, it is using the same forced plans. It is still executing. This is the second execution. Did you observe? It used the same execution plan, same plans like the previous one and for the late one. These are the execution plans that we force. So no matter how many times with different parameters we use, it will actually use the same execution plans. But let me go ahead and show you with a different parameter, right? Completely different parameter. Let's execute that and see. It will definitely use the same execution plan because we forced it, right? See, it used the same execution plan. Very simple. Now, let me go ahead and run those ad hoc queries. Sometimes we have to run also some of the ad hoc queries instead of running those store procedures, right? So let me go ahead and execute these two same queries with a direct ad hoc queries, right? When I execute that, let's see if it still uses the forced plans, right? It's executing. But if you see the ad hoc queries, this looks the same, but the second one, is it the same? No, right? It's completely different. So that means it is not using the It is not actually using the execution plans that we forced. It is using completely different. Now, why is that? Whenever we force the queries, right, it only uses for that particular query because that's a store procedure, right? That execution plan is only forced for that particular store procedure. Now, if you take the code out of the store procedure and if you execute it by ad hoc, SQL Server doesn't want it to use that. Like query store wanted to create a new execution plan for these ad hoc queries. So we have to keep that in mind, right? Let me go ahead and open my second demo. Demo two. Now, let's see how query store will act if we turn off the query store, because we already have those forced plans, right, which are enabled. But what if I just go ahead and turn off the query store completely on the database level? I turned it off. So do you think those forced plans are still active? No, it doesn't. So let's go ahead and see by executing the same store procedure with the same queries, right? Enable the execution plan on, execute it, and see the execution plan on. As we turned it off, right, it will go ahead and create different execution plans. Now, why is it? If you see here, did you see here? It actually used different execution plans, which we did not force. That means if you turn the query store off, then even though you have those active forced plans, as you completely shut off the doors of the query store, it won't use those forced query plans. What if I turned it off right now? Right now, our query store information is actually in the query store, right? But we just turned it off. But now, if I turn it on, what will happen? Because our queries are still there inside the query store. Nobody has cleaned it out, right? If you turn that on and go ahead and execute it again, the same queries, to see if it will actually use those query plans, the forced query plans. It's still executing. These two looks good. These two looks good. And if you see, did you observe they are actually using those forced query plans? That's how the query store works, right? And then there is also one more option. Like if you turn the query store itself off, then what will happen? It cannot use the forced plans inside the query store. But what if instead of turning it off, if you put read only, you are just making alter database and then setting the query store just in read only. In that scenario, those forced plans will be active as well, and queries will actually use those query plans, forced query plans. Now, if you observe the execution plan here, it's recommending the index over here, right? It is recommending this particular index. So what if I go ahead and create that recommended index here? The same exact query, I'm copying it and running it over here. It executed fine. And then let me completely free the cache, right? To know if that will make the change. Like I created a non-clustered index right now. So let me go ahead and free up the entire cache to know if those forced plans are going to be used even after creating that index, right? Before that index is not there. So if I go ahead and execute this particular store procedure again and see if that particular is used, there is not much difference. But here, there is a difference, sorry, because if you observe here, it is actually using my non-clustered index. If you observe here, let me show you. If you observe, I'm unable to actually enable my zoom it. I don't know what has happened. So if you observe here in the object, it is actually showing the exact non-clustered index that I actually created, right? Even here, it is actually using that index. So It just, that means it actually created a new plan, right? So whenever we modify the index, whenever we add the index, those forced plans will not be used because we are modifying, right? So what if I go ahead and drop the index this time? I just created, and we have seen that it has created the new plans, right? What if I go ahead and actually drop the index? For that, I think I have to run these statements. I'm sorry, I did something wrong here. Let me go ahead and unforce the plans here. So how do we unforce the plan, right? Just click here and then unforce the plan. And then say okay. And we wanted to do the same with the second statement as well, to know unforce by clicking on this. Unforce the plan, unforce. So we don't have any force. So what if I go ahead and drop the index, right? And then I go ahead and execute this particular query. So previously it has actually, I did something wrong here actually. So let me go ahead and drop that. And then, so when you observe here, the new execution plans get created. So here I actually created an index, right? So let me go ahead and execute this one. And the new plans got created by using my new index. Now, after going ahead here and refreshing it, if you see for the plan one, the latest plan is 17. So let me go ahead and force that plan, the latest one, right? Which is using my non-clustered index. And for the plan number two, you can see plan number 18 is our latest one, which is using our non-clustered index. So I want to force that as well. And then let me go ahead and now see if it is actually using that plan, right? When you execute that, because we force that plan, it will go ahead and use that non-clustered index. If you see there in the object, it will be also be used here as well, the non-clustered index that I created. And now let me go ahead and drop that index, right? Cannot drop the index because it does not exist, really. Oh, I already dropped it, sorry. So if I execute that after dropping, right? If I execute that, what will happen? It's not using that index anymore because index is no more there. So it actually has created a brand new execution plan, which actually use a different index, because the one which we created is NCI, but then here, it's actually using IX, if you observe here. So that means dropping the index and recreating the index will actually, you know, it will not help the optimizer to use the forced plan, you know? So that's how the indexes, how does that those affect actually? So let me go back to my slides back again. Where are we? Sorry, something happened. So here we are. So for some reasons, the forcing of the plans failed, right? Even though we force the plan, sometimes they fail. Now, when does they fail? Whenever you drop the index, right? At this moment, we have seen in our demo, whenever we drop the index, we get those errors. When you check on query store, you get that no index forcing error, but that doesn't mean that query itself will get failed. But if you go to the query store and see those errors, you see no index. Because of the no index, it cannot actually use that forced plan. Whenever you change the index name, the same forced plan will happen. And whenever you remove the columns from the index, that will happen again. And also, if you drop and recreate the store procedure, right, that will change the object ID. So in that particular scenario, it cannot use the forced plan. But rather, if you use the alter, and if you do not make any changes, like space changes, even when you do the space changes, the optimizer will go ahead and create a brand new plan for that particular query. So you have to keep few things, you have to remember a couple of things. And there are a couple more things we have to remember that, as we discussed, when we turn off the query store, no forced plans will be active anymore, right? And if you have a forced plan inside your query store, that doesn't get aged out of the query store. And we cannot force the plan on the read-only replica, right? If you enabled it, enable the query store on your primary replica where you have read-write, it is active there and it will actually populate all the query store data into the secondary read-only, but it cannot modify or it cannot insert the query store data at the secondary level because that's the read-only replica. And when you have some doubts, right, if the forced plan is, if the plan is forced or not, by looking at the execution plan itself, you can check if the plan is forced or not. And even though if you have a forced plan in place, if you are moving your database from dev, test, and QA, those, that might be a little bit different when you are using these forced plans because the environment is different, the data is different. You have to consider all those into consideration. And when you check for the forced plan, when the schema changes like the index with the object names, then it won't use the forced plan, right? We discussed about this previously. And then this automatical plan correction come in place in SQL Server 2017 and Azure SQL. If you have these two databases, like if you have Azure SQL, that means you are already using the query store with the automatic plan correction. But for the SQL Server 2017, you need to have that enterprise edition level to have this option enabled. And even though automatic plan correction is at the database level setting, it is disabled by default until you are on Azure. So you have to enable that option at the database level. When this automatic plan correction is on, it will go ahead and check which plan is optimal by itself. You do not have to intervene in choosing the plans, but you still have the ability to choose the plans if you want by looking at the information from SysDMDB tuning recommendations. You get those recommendations. By choosing from there, you can actually manually force the plans, even though your automatic plan correction is enabled. And if you are not on the enterprise edition, this option is not enabled. And you can see nothing in SysDMDB tuning recommendations if you do not have the enterprise edition. How does this automatic tuning works, right? So query store actually, first step, it will go ahead and compare the current plan, the current forced plan with the previous plan. If there is a regression, right? If there is a performance degrade, then it will go ahead and force the last good known plan. And then it will start monitoring again to see if this plan is good, if the current force plan is good, or if there is any regression again. Like if there is an update stats going on, right? On your weekends, you'll go ahead and run those update stats. So whenever you run the update stats, then it will unforce it. Whenever there is a forced plan failure, it will unforce it. And it will do this unforce. And then again, it will go ahead in the cycle form, it will compare the existing plan with the previous plans. And then the same cycle repeats. That means you do not have to intervene all the time. Though this is not like the complete solution that I see, but then it will automatically check and always validate the plans which are already there for the performance degrade, and then choose the best plan by itself. Is this accurate all the time? Maybe not, because it works automatically, but you can rely on it most of the time because it is doing work for you, right? Without your intervention, it can go ahead and compare and validate all the time behind the scenes to get that good enough plans. If it didn't find good enough and it found the next plan as good enough, it will unforce the existing plan and it will force the new plan, which is optimal. It can do that all by itself. And it is designed with operational telemetry from Azure SQL implementation. So first, this option is enabled in SQL Azure, and then it bought into SQL Server 2017 and 16 on-premises. Some of the things we have to know: only the plans that are forced with the automatic plan correction feature can be automatically unforced. But if you manually forced a plan by using SysDMDB tuning recommendations, then automatic plan corrections do not even touch it. It cannot unforce them. And how do we monitor the automatic correction, right? Once the automatic correction is going on, there might be some failures, right? There might be some failures. You might change the schema of the stored procedure, or you added the index or dropped the index, and now that plan has been unforced. But then you need to know if those plans that are actually chosen are failing or are they working properly. You can choose extended events to do that. You can actually create the extended events, especially for these tuning errors, right? Especially for these forced plan errors. And you can also get that information if you are on the enterprise edition by using SysDMDB tuning recommendations. But then if you restart the SQL Server, all the data will be lost from this query, right? And that's only in the enterprise edition, you'll get that SysDMDB tuning recommendations. You can run the query on standard edition, but you will not get anything. You won't see any results. So what did we learn in this session today? We have seen the overview of the query store, and especially we mainly focused on forcing the plan using the query store, and how does the changing the index and dropping the index, altering the store procedure will actually affect and create a new execution plan without using that forced plan. We have also seen the automatic plan correction, how it actually works, and what are some of the considerations that we have to put it in our minds before using the automatic plan correction. I don't say it's the complete solution. Always the complete solution is to modify our code to make sure it always create that optimal plans. But then for a DBA and a developer, this is like a beautiful feature that we can rely on. These are some of the resources I followed. If you wanted to know more about Query Store, please follow these resources. I would like to thank Microsoft Festival and all the organizers and then sponsors, and especially Thea, for giving me this wonderful opportunity to present for your, festival. Thank you so much.
No problem. And again, thanks for joining us today. So we have two questions from Marcos Carreiro, and two from myself as well, because I'm not so familiar with the Query Store. So I know how to use it, but I've never used it like in a practical way. The first question that we have from Marcos Carneiros is, if you are familiar with the system and develop all your SPROCs, your start procedures, to control the data access, would be better to use a query hinge rather than like Query Stars? Like, if you are so familiar with, how the query should be returned, probably if the query returns kind of index with lookup or rather than cluster head index scan, what would be better, like to use query hinge or query stars?
You mean query hinge? What kind of query hinge? No, I can answer the question, but then yep. I am not able to understand the question properly.
Index hints, for example, first hints.
Maybe I have to look into that, because you mean query hint, meaning you're forcing a query to use a particular index?
Exactly, yeah, that's what I meant.
In that particular scenario as well, it won't use the force plan, because because the query plan that you already forced is not using that query, and now you are forcing the query to use that query hint, right? If that query hint is already inside your store procedure, and then after creating the execution plan, you're forcing that, then it will go ahead and use. But then if you already forced a plan and then you went ahead and remodified the store procedure by creating those like forced plan, you change the script of the store procedure, then it will go ahead and create a brand new execution plan. And now you have to make sure to unforce it and to force this brand new created execution plan.
Oh gosh, I didn't even know that. Is that clear, Marcus? I saw someone getting dropping some messages. Excellent success. Thanks for the presentation.
Thank you so
Thanks.
Much.
Pretty yes, according to Marcus, it's pretty much. We have a second question from Marcus as well.
Uh-huh.
If you have a forced plan, drop or creating the user index with the same name, will use it again, right?
So dropping and creating the index, right?
Yep.
Let me think about that. If you are creating the same name, right? The same name index,
yep.
you're not modifying any data. Why would you drop and create the same index? I don't know, but if you are modifying any, for example, let me say, if you are including a particular column, right, with the same exact name, if you're just going and including a single column in the included or into the index, then that will definitely change. It will actually change because if we have seen in our demo, I'm actually using the non-clustered index. I forced that plan and then I went ahead and created another index by just including a column in it. So even though your name is same, if you're adding any more columns, then it will go ahead and not use the forced index. It will have to create a brand new index one more time. So if you're making any modifications, you know, then even though you alter the store procedure, even without dropping, like if you drop and recreate the store procedure, that will definitely create an entire new query ID, right? So that will generate a new plan. But then if you even alter the store procedure without dropping it, even if you have some query text changes like commas or the maintaining some space in between changing the code, even that will create a brand new execution plan. That's how it works actually. So you have to make sure unforce and then force if you do not have that auto plan correction on.
Okay, okie dokie, yep. Thanks for answer that. We have two questions from me, another from a friend of mine. So, this the another question from Tasio Carlini. First, thanks for the presentation. And if I run the BCC free proc hash, should the forced plan disappear or does it remain in any way because it's forced? You know, like if I run the BCC, the plan is going to be evicted for the execution plan or
no, it will actually stay because cache is completely different from query store, right?
That's awesome.
Because query store, you will have that interval put, you will actually put that interval when you created that query store, you need to make sure those settings when you wanted to go ahead and free up all the plans inside the cache. But then if you force something and then you clean up the DBCC free proc cache, it doesn't have anything to do with the query store because in the query store, it's already stored.
It does make sense. Yes, for sure. We have the same, like we have store for that plan, like in the database itself, you know? So that's question for me.
Then I have to see that. I have to confirm that.
Okay. Yeah. Probably there is some kind of link inside of the execution memory cache. So that's for me. I have two, but I'm going to start for the hardest one. So what would be a feasible solution like to get the plan forced in the secondary replica, in case you are using the secondary replica as a read like workload replica, you know? I assume you have like our availability group like, you know, primary and secondary replica, and you split up your workload. The first is going to write down data on the primary replica, and the second one is going to just read, like, you know, reporting, for example. Right. What would be a feasible solution, like, once the query store doesn't allow us to force a plan on the secondary replica?
It doesn't, because it doesn't actually store, because it will actually populate this primary data into that, and then it will use, but then it won't, you know, it won't actually, for because the read queries might be different on the read section, right? The write section, you will only write the queries, but then if you are reading those queries over there, it will create the plans for itself on the read, but it won't get stored on that server. But if you are doing some the same query, if you are running here as well as there, it will use that information. It will use that store procedure, the same execution plan.
Yep, I'm happy with that. So, okay, another one. Is it, I'm a little bit familiar with Azure SQL Database. I know that in Azure SQL Database, you are able to force an execution plan from that feature called automatically execution plan, whatever. I don't remember. I don't recall the name. is it possible to do something the same way on SQL Server on-premises? Like, in case, I suppose that I don't want to go to the query store, choose, pick up a plan, you know, and force it. Now, is there some kind of way to force the plan automatically without getting any intervention, manual or human being intervention inside of the query store?
Oh, so you are saying with included query store, like with the automatic plan correction on, you are asking me like, so once the plan is on, once the auto correction is on, I do not have to touch it. Is that the question?
Yeah, exactly.
No, that's not the complete solution, because even though your auto plan correction is on, most of the time it works, but then you have to make sure if there are any failures on those forced plans by making sure you are enabling those extended events. And if you go ahead and look into those any failures on the extended events, you should be fine. And if you find any failures, then you have to peek into it. Why you got failure? Did the index got created or dropped or what happened? And make sure that plan is actually forced, whatever plan you got, you know, whatever plan you think that is optimal. You have to check whether that plan is actually there. Sometimes the auto, you know, auto plan correction might also have those glitches, a little bit glitches. So that is when the extended events come into place.
Okay, Doc, thanks. We don't have any we don't have any other question. I just like to ask you something. The SQL community, Brazilian SQL community is asking you to share that your slide deck with them.
Oh, definitely. I will be sharing on onto my GitHub, and then I will provide the link. Where should I post the link?
Just, I can talk with you in the private. We could do like.
Yeah, sure. And how many? Like,
okay.
How many did we have max count today? The attendee count?
We had 76 over the last 3 minutes. The number dropped to 62, but because probably we got into the next agenda, you know, the next scheduling. We were running with 76 person in the call. So thanks so much. It's a high number.
Oh, awesome. But I have seen like 86 too at certain point of time.
Yeah, at the beginning we had 86.
Yeah.
But I can provide the numbers for you if you want.
Yeah, later. The max number, you know?
Okay, yeah, for sure. I know what you mean.
Thank you.